report a shot fired at officer trying to stop the vehicle.
We have one officer shot.
We got shots fired. Sounded like an automatic firearm.
Copy, code red, shots fired.
We have an active shooter. We have an active shooter inside the warehouse.
Now it's Shots Fired with your host, TJ Kirgin, Dinah Death Milberg, and the lovely Crystal Powers.
Fish, can you hear me now? Are we on the air? We are on the air. Hey, it's TJ with Shots Fired. I don't know what was going on there. I don't know if you could hear me. I don't know if I could hear. I definitely couldn't hear you, St. Louis, or Missouri, or Rolla, or wherever you're listening to Shots Fired. This is TJ Kirgin, a.k.a. Sig, Glock, and Colt, your neighborhood warlord. You know, why do people call me the local warlord? Well, it's because I'm that guy, right? I'm that guy that lives down the street, that if the crap hits the fan, you go to my house. That's what you say to me anyway. If crap hits the fan, I'm coming to your house. No, you're not. No, you are not coming to my house. I've got all the toilet paper I need, and I plan on keeping it. But nonetheless, that's the guy that I am. I'm the guy that you call when it's time to buy your first gun. I'm the guy that you call when you want your mom trained to defend herself in her house. I'm the guy that you call when you have a daughter getting ready to go to college and you want her to be taught and given the weapons necessary, both in her mind and her hands and her pocket, to defend herself against scumbags. You know, when she's not in your presence where you are protecting her. So I'm that guy, right? And I have been an advocate for the Second Amendment for as long as I can remember, ever since I learned about the Constitution, I learned about freedom. But I really got active right after Sandy Hook, which was in 2013, I believe. And it's ironic because other people that got really active after Sandy Hook are now being targeted by everybody, primarily the George Soros-funded Everytown, as well as the families of the Sandy Hook victims. God rest those children's souls. I'll tell you what I'm talking about, and I'm talking about the persecution and absolute destruction of dissidents, what the media call conspiracy theorists. Can you imagine being a conspiracy theorist? We all are a conspiracy theorist at some point, I think. Doesn't matter what side of the fence you're on. Doesn't matter, you know, you're right, you're left, you're white, you're black, you're gay, you're straight. Everybody's got a conspiracy theory. Because and the definition of conspiracy theory just means that you have a theory about something that doesn't match the norm, what the normies' theory is on that something. And it's not necessarily the normies, it's in some cases, it's the government's theory or the media's theory, which is one and the same. Even though I'm talking to you on a media channel right now, you know, fortunately, my station that I'm on right now is too small to be influenced by the government. At least as far as I know, I don't think Tracy's been bought off yet. Otherwise, I wouldn't be on the air, although they do put that disclaimer at the beginning of the show. Oh, maybe. Anyway, I'm talking about the conspiracy theorist in chief, talking about Alex Jones from Infowars, right? The extremely successful, extremely conspiracy theory related guy, Alex Jones. Just last week, he lost two lawsuit decisions against the families of Sandy Hook victims. Now, these are the same families that sued Remington and won $73 million, not because Remington manufactured the firearm that was used, because that would be illegal against the PCLAA or whatever it's called, the Protection Act that keeps for people from being able to do frivolous lawsuits against gun manufacturers. They actually sued on a different grounds, and they won basically $73 million from the bankrupt Remington. Forced Remington into bankruptcy because they said that the marketing Remington did appealed to young males and therefore appealed to this mass shooter, and that somehow, some way, the advertising and marketing that Remington had created surrounding the AR-15 somehow in some way influenced the shooter to go and massacre all those children, those, you know, all those years ago in 2013. Same thing's going to happen with every other mass shooting that's happened since then. I promise you, The lawsuits just haven't been filed yet or haven't been won yet. It's getting worse and worse out there. But now this has nothing to do with firearms. Alex Jones has been sued for simply stating that he didn't believe that Sandy Hook was a real thing. That was his conspiracy theory. He was proven wrong. You know, it actually did happen. Those children did die. But I know a lot of people who, you know, thought that it didn't happen, that it was a government false flag or, well, you know, false flag actually happens. It's just not what you think it is. But a lot of people thought that this was just all actors and stuff like that. I heard that from a lot of folks. You know, a lot of, but these same folks, I mean, a couple of these same people also think the earth is flat. Sorry, we're not going to get into that because if you think the earth is flat, you're just an idiot. Well, I'm not going there. I'm not going there. But anyway, Alex Jones did a series of shows about, you know, and said on the air that this was a hoax and that it didn't happen. And so they sued him for it. The families of the children sued him and won last week a little over $4 million in damages, $4.1 million in damages. But then, but wait, there's more. They then won $45.2 million in punitive damages. Totaling out at about $49.1 million that Alex Jones is now has been judged to have to pay the families of Sandy Hook. What kind of clown world do we live in where you could win that kind of judgment against somebody simply for accusing you of being full of crap, you know, accusing the media of being full of crap? Somehow the parents said that this accusation, you know, hurt them so deeply that they deserve $49 million. Whatever makes you sleep better at night, I guess. I'll tell you what, the attorneys for Alex Jones, they're stating that, you know, it's not over, obviously. It's actually $49.3 million. The beautiful part here is that they had to sue Alex, I guess, in Texas because that's where he's incorporated at. And there just happens to be, because Texas is an awesome state. There's a statute in Texas that caps Texas punitive damages per victim at $750,000. So that means that each family member that's listed on this lawsuit would only be able to receive up to $750,000 based on Texas statute. We have a caller. Before we go to the phone, though, I want to say that Alex Jones, they're not done. So now they've nailed him for almost $50 million in a judgment. But now somehow through this thing, I haven't got the whole story. I'm going to have it after this break. But they have now turned over his private text messages to the January 6th committee. So now they're going from civil lawsuit in Texas over what he said on his TV show, radio show, podcast. Now they're attacking him with the January 6th committee, basically saying he had something to do with the violent siege at the Capitol. And I say that in all jest because that was not a violent siege. You ain't seen nothing. All right, let's go to the phone. Who do we got on the phone?
This is Mike from Warrington.
Hey, Mike, what's up, man?
And you're talking about how Remington was being sued because of their marketing. So, like, back when Columbine happened in the late 90s,
yeah.
There was a movie, Basketball Diaries, with Leonardo DiCaprio.
Yeah.
In that movie, he portrays a part where he goes into a classroom and starts shooting kids with a shotgun. And he's wearing the trench coat and stuff.
Right.
And that was just a few years before Columbine. So why isn't the movie industry being sued?
That's a fantastic point. Unfortunately, life imitates art and art imitates life. And you could blame these mass shootings on any number of video games, violent movies, documentaries. You could literally blame a shooting on another shooting because one shooting gets a copycat. You know, the recent grocery store guy was just copycatting the guy in Australia, not Australia, but down by Australia. You know, it was a copycat mass shooting. It's the lawsuits in this country, I think, have gone, the legal system, the civil legal system is absolutely out of control. Anybody can sue anybody for anything. And these ridiculous judgments that can put people out of business, can take away the livelihoods of all their employees, can happen so easily and so quickly because our legal system needs to be revamped. Thanks for your call, man. Have a good one out there in Warrington. Keep your head on a swivel. I got to go to a break. And we're back talking about Alex Jones, the conspiracy theorist in chief. You know, I don't agree with everything Alex Jones does or says, although I think some of it is, I think some of it deserves, you know, a Nobel Peace Prize. I mean, like some of the stuff he did on COVID was just absolutely incredible. But you also have to realize that he is a, you know, he's out there as a shock jock. You know, he's trying to shock you, you know, just like Howard Stern did in the 90s. You know, but instead of boobies and sex jokes, you know, he's talking conspiracy theories. And it just got him, you know, it just got him sued by the Sandy Hook parents. We talked about this earlier. They won a judgment of almost $50 million against him. And hopefully the Texas statute that reduces punitive damages to $750,000 per victim will save him at least from destruction. Now, granted, if you research his net worth, which is never 100% reliable, I mean, if you look at my net worth on Google, it says I'm worth like $30 million. I am not worth that much. So, but it does say, according to CNN, according to Google and all the websites, his net worth is worth about $270 million. So we're talking about, you know, them going after 20% of his net worth. I mean, that's a pretty big hit at his age. You know, that would hurt. That would hurt quite a bit. So I hope he, you know, yeah, I think he was wrong for stating that it was a lie when it obviously wasn't. And not, you know, he's media. All media should tell the truth. But at the same time, I think this judgment is just ridiculous. But that's not all. Now that that is behind them, CNN is reporting today that approximately 2 years' worth of text messages sent and received by right-wing conspiracy theorist Alex Jones have been turned over to the House Select Committee investigating the January 6th insurrection, a person familiar with the matter told CNN today. The messages were handed over to the committee by Mark Blankston, the attorney who represented two Sandy Hook parents who successfully sued Jones in Texas and won nearly $50 million in a civil trial. How does the lawyer suing Jones in a civil trial for the parents? So he's a Soros funded lawyer. How does he end up with these text messages, 2 years worth of text messages, and then turn them over? Did they find him in discovery and now they're using them against him? That's pretty scary stuff. Let's see. During the trial, Bankston revealed that one of Jones's lawyers had messed up, quote unquote, and inadvertently sent him the 2 years of text messages. Bankston also said during the trial that January 6th committee had expressed interest in the material. Jeez, that's pretty bad. So they got him for $50 million, and because his attorneys messed up and accidentally sent 2 years worth of privileged text messages, private communications, regarding the January 6th event, you know, that has now been turned over to the January 6th committee. Who knows what kind of witch hunt this will end in? You know, they're going to literally burn him at the stake. I think they'll probably do that. They'll probably light a giant funeral pyre right in front of the, you know, the Washington Monument and burn Alex Jones alive. That is probably what the Dems would like to do to him. And I don't know, man. It's such a witch hunt. And this is the same kind of witch hunt that they will do to me. And it's the same kind of witch hunt that they will do to every other conservative pundit, reporter, advocate, activist. So, or you, if you post anything on social media, they'll just come at you a different way. They might not hit you with $50 million. They might just
hit you with, you know, $50 or $50,000 or $5,000. Or they'll fine you because you posted something on Facebook that they didn't like. It didn't fit their community standards. You know, that's where we're going with this, with the social credit score system. You might not actually write a check for $5,000, but you might not get that loan for that living room furniture you want that's $5,000 because your social credit affected your credit score. Huh? Think about it. That's where we're going in this BS world, unless we do something about it. I don't know what that is. I think it begins at the voting box, which we just did in our primaries. We're looking forward to November 2nd. Hopefully going to be able to take back the House and the Senate. I don't have a whole lot of faith in that because we haven't done enough to secure our elections. But I don't want to say anything about election fraud because the next thing you know, somebody could sue me and I could be out $50 million. You know what, though? They wouldn't sue me for $50 million. Because you know how these lawsuits work? The first thing they do in a lawsuit, I found this out the hard way. The first thing they do in a lawsuit is they demand to see your tax returns and your financials. And they demand to see your bank statements. Because the opposing counsel, the people suing you, they want to know how much money can they squeeze out of you without putting you into bankruptcy. And that's why it's always the first thing they want to know is how much money does this guy have? And then that's how they decide what to sue you for. That's the kind of stuff I'm talking about when I say that the civil criminal or the civil justice system, the civil court system is absolutely made for ambulance chasing attorneys that do these BS extortion campaigns, resulting in, you know, text messages now being sent to the January 6th committee, even though they won the $50 million. That had to be just the last little FU that they wanted to stick in there. I don't know. So in other news, there's other fun things to talk about. You remember how we talked a few months ago about forced reset triggers, FRT, rare breed forced reset triggers, which were copycatted by a company in Florida, Big Daddy Unlimited, and that both of those companies were then targeted by the ATF, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Federal Agency, saying that these forced reset triggers were, in fact, machine guns and therefore covered under the National Firearms Act and the Gun Control Act and could not be sold, and any that were in possession needed to be destroyed or turned in. Now, they have not actually come out with a rule for that. That hasn't actually happened because the forced reset trigger, by definition, is not a machine gun. However, I have shot one, and it is a machine gun. It's not a machine gun by definition, which means it's not a machine gun. But it's a machine gun. What they need to do is they need to change the definition of a machine gun, but they haven't done that. The definition of a machine gun is that a single pull of the trigger results in more than one fire of the gun. All right? So you pull the trigger once, two bullets come out, that's a machine gun. Okay? With a forced reset trigger, you pull the trigger once, a bullet comes out, you let the trigger go, and it automatically fires another one with your retention of your finger on the trigger as you let go, right? If you keep the trigger pinned back, it's supposed to not fire the second round. I found that to be almost impossible to do. I actually tested one of these things, and it was like hot potato. I got rid of it. I shipped it to a buddy of mine. I kept the tracking information in case the ATF ever wanted to ask me where it went. But I think they're unsafe, but they're not illegal. And somebody was charged for the first time in the United States with possession of one. We're going to talk about that after the break. All right, we're back talking about the first guy ever to be charged with possession of a machine gun when all he possessed was a forced reset trigger from Rare Breed. Rare Breed currently suing the ATF because the ATF basically said that, hey, that's a machine gun, you can't sell those. And he said, no, it's not a machine gun. Your definition of machine gun says this. This does not describe my product. It's not a machine gun. And so he's playing a gray area. It's not even gray. It's pretty white, but it's a loophole. It's technology has created a way for him to basically have a fun switch on a gun that is not a machine gun. But common sense probably says it should be. You know, a binary trigger fires when you pull the trigger and when you release the trigger. If you don't release the trigger, it doesn't fire. The forced reset trigger will fire again and again and again as long as you don't apply too much pressure to the pull. If you pull and keep the trigger pinned, but not forcefully pinned, it will continue to fire. Pop, 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 pop. And I'll tell you what, it's very dangerous. It's very dangerous. A lot of fun, but very, very dangerous. I prefer to do to have my fun legally, which is why I buy real machine guns and I go through the NFA process. I do all the stupid things that I'm forced to do by these unconstitutional laws because they are laws and I am a law-abiding citizen, to a point. Now, with that said, this guy in Holyoke, Massachusetts, he's not a good guy. He's not a good guy, and he's got some serious issues to face here. Let's see here. He was arrested and indicted for possessing over 40 machine guns, which were seized by the FBI and the ATF. Daniel A. Augusto was indicted in Springfield, Massachusetts on unlawful possession of machine guns, 6 counts of unlawful possession of unregistered firearms, as well as making false statements to federal agents. He's a 56-year-old guy, and he's not a good guy. I'm going to say that again. He's a criminal, and he's a POS, a piece of SH asterisk T, right? The reason I know he's a POS is because the first statement he made to the ATF, the reason he's being charged with making a false statement, by the way, don't lie to the feds. It's a dumb idea. You know, it's much better just to keep your mouth shut. He said, oh, those aren't my guns. Those are my daughter and my son-in-law's guns, and I did not ask them to buy them. He blamed the machine guns and the unregistered short-barreled rifles and the unmarked suppressors that he was in possession of on his daughter. What kind of dude does that? His daughter and son-in-law is like, yeah, no, they're not our guns. He's full of crap, and you can go ahead and take him away now. Let's see here. These are the guns and the triggers and the packs and whatnot that he was caught with. One PTR Industry PTR 9, 9mm, with one magazine and an altered HK-MP5 type machine gun trigger housing installed. Okay, so a PTR 9mm is like a clone of an HK-MP5, and he had a fake full auto MP5 auto sear installed. Okay, that is a crime. Okay, that is a machine gun. No doubt about it. Let's move on to the next one. 38 Glock switches. Now, what these things are, we're going to talk about these a little bit in the last segment. These are something that is being sold on Chinese websites to American gangbangers and, obviously, 56-year-old white dudes in Massachusetts for really cheap. It's just a little piece of metal that you basically remove the back plate from your Glock 19, which is done with a pocket knife or a pin and your thumb. Very easy to do. Take it off. You put this new backplate on, and it makes your Glock 19 a machine gun. And you can buy these things, or you could buy them on Wish.com and things like that. The ATF is really having a problem with it because they are flooding the inner cities. I mean, the inner cities are just full of these switches. Yeah, I think they're like $30 or something. It turns a Glock 19, which is a perfectly legal handgun, into a full auto, you know, death machine, according to the liberals. And actually, they're... You know, you think a gangbanger can't hit what they're aiming at when they aim their gun sideways and grab their crotch and throw the bullets at their target. Wait till you do it with a full auto Glock 19. Even I, who know how to shoot a full auto Glock 19, typically would only put maybe one or two of my 30 rounds into the target. All the rest of them are going to the sky. You can't control it. It's absolutely impossible. It's nothing but a novelty. But anyway, he had 38 of those, so that's 38 more machine guns that he had in his possession. Now, that's, remember, he's got 40 counts here. One is the HK, 38 is the Glock triggers. That's 39. Then we get to
Three, rare breed FRT-15 forced reset triggers designed to allow drop-in installation in AR-15 type firearms with no serial number. They had one other Tommy trigger, FR-15 3MD forced reset trigger, so we had four of them total. Then he had one Imperial Arms PS-90 5.7. He had one PTR Industries PTR-9, another fake HK with a collapsible shoulder stock that makes it an SBR. Had a thread protector on the barrel so it could take a suppressor. That's not illegal, but it did have it. It was a short barrel, though, so it's a short barrel rifle. He had an Intratec Tech-9 with a secondary forward grip, okay? By putting a forward grip on a pistol, you've now created an AOW. That's an NFA violation. It's like the feds don't even have the right laws applied to this. I know this. It doesn't even make sense. And then two black firearm silencers with no markings. Okay, that's a problem. You can't make your own suppressors. Lots of companies sent the parts out to lots of people so that they could make their own suppressors. Basically, they called them solvent traps. If you have one of those, you're an idiot. Get rid of it. It's a felony. You're going to do 10 years in prison and $250,000 fine if you get caught with it. He had two of those. And so if you add it all up, 10 years and $250,000 for each of these things, this guy's going to be in this for about $5 million and 75 years in prison should all these charges stick. Now, like I said, there's no doubt he's in possession of a short barrel rifle without tax stamp. He's in possession of two suppressors without tax stamp. He's in possession of almost 40 machine guns without proper licensing. It's tax stamps. But the fact that they're adding in these forced reset triggers, which are not machine guns, should be concerning to all of us, because it's a perfect example of presidents and their three-letter agencies creating rules, not laws, that's supposed to be done in Congress, creating rules and redefining things, you know, like they redefined what a woman is, what they've redefined what a recession is. Now they're redefining what a machine gun is. I guarantee you that this case is part of a bigger push to redefine all semi-automatic guns as a machine gun, because under one current lawsuit with the federal government by a anti-gun organization, George Soros funded, they're trying to say that that Glock 19, that all Glock 19s should be considered machine guns because it's so easy to make them a machine gun. And that any idiot can do it with a $30 chunk of metal. Or an AR-15 should be a machine gun because anybody can do it with a rubber band or a paper clip or a coat hanger. There's lots of ways to make machine guns. Don't YouTube that. ATF will show up at your front door, I promise. So that's super concerning. In other news regarding these Glock switches, I get a kick out of this article from the Shreveport Times. Federal authorities in Louisiana are warning the public that a new firearm attachment that enables a pistol to fire like a machine gun, commonly known as a Glock switch, this quarter-sized attachment is added to pistols and allows the weapon to fully unload the magazine with one pull of the trigger. This is the best part. The shooter only has to pull the trigger once for the weapon to fire hundreds of rounds, the Federal Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms says. This is a quick process. 30 rounds can be fired in 1 to 2 seconds. I'm not sure I've ever seen a belt-fed Glock 19, but when the ATF says that the Glock 19 can fire hundreds of rounds when it's made into a machine gun, it shows that the people that are enforcing the laws and giving the quotes to the media are just as inept in reference to the details of what they're doing, the guns that they're doing it with, as the media themselves. We've got another caller who's on the air with me right now.
Hey, my name is Kevin.
Hey, Kevin.
Hey, so you have fans everywhere. I'm listening on the app out of Colorado Springs right now.
Sweet. That's pretty awesome.
I've actually made it to your store in Missouri one time when I was on my way to North Carolina. I was like a kid in a candy store. I was having so much fun.
That's awesome to hear.
I'm pretty sure I annoyed your employees while I was there, too.
Oh, that's okay. They annoy our customers right back.
buy a couple cigars and some rounds of ammo while I was there.
That's awesome. Two things that are close to my heart.
Oh yeah, and then I've actually been following your Facebook page. I want to say going on like 9 years now. Like all the way back to when there was a tactical shit elite page as like just the fan page.
Oh wow, yeah. That we had the Tactical SH Asterisk T Elite page. It was a group, and that was a group of the Tactical SH Asterisk T heads. I kind of miss those days. You know, the days of Facebook, they've silenced me so much that I don't participate much on the Facebook anymore. I kind of just live on Instagram like I'm banished from the kingdom. But I do miss those days, and I thank you for sticking with me this long. That's pretty awesome to know. How did you find out about the show to listen to it in Colorado Springs and get the app?
So I've actually been listening ever since there was a podcast. I've actually heard every single podcast episode, and then all the radio version ones just dropped randomly out of nowhere. So I was listening to the once a week show,
right?
And then all the radio ones just dropped, and I was like, oh, okay, yeah, they're just didn't post them. And, you know, I figured out over the course of the last like 3 days that it's like, oh yeah, you guys are going every single day. So I was like, awesome. I'm going to call and thank you guys for, you know, everything you do. Cause, actually listening to the podcast back when it was just the podcast, you and Dynadesk, you know, talking about, being prepared in your home, knowing where everything is. A couple weeks ago, our alarm system went off at like 2:30 in the morning.
And, that's pucker factor.
Oh yeah, definitely. And it was just, you know, I went through the pistol, you know, in my nightstand, and then I started moving towards the stairway. I actually bought my house specifically because I have a kill hallway. I come up, you know, a set of stairs, and I got a long hallway.
Right.
I was like, this is perfect. I want the house.
Yeah.
But while I was standing there, you know, getting the sleep out of my eyes, your guys' voices were in the back of my head saying, gain your composure and make sure that you know where everything is. So I was able to take a step back, check and make sure the kid was still in her room and wasn't going to be coming up the stairs.
Right.
And, you know, took a step back, checked on her, wife went and grabbed the kid, took her to our room. Once I knew they were good, went to go clear the house. Luckily, it just turned out that a whole bunch of, you know, wind put fresh, you know, air pressure in the garage and pushed it open just enough. The sensor went off, but
you know what that wind did for you is that wind gave you a stress test, and it gave you a bit of real world training, because the next time that goes off, you know, you're gonna have even better composure and know exactly what you need to do even faster the next time. So I thank God sometimes when those things happen, because they allow me to kind of pressure test myself. And you did the right thing. I'll tell you, by you telling me that me and Dynadeath's words were in the back of your mind at that moment gave me the goosebumps. I really appreciate that. I truly do. Because that's really what I do this for. I'm not doing it for fame. I'm not doing it, you know, to make money. I don't even promote the podcast well enough. I probably ought to do it better. But I do it for guys like you so that I can teach what I've been taught, because I'm the perpetual student. Thanks for listening, buddy, and keep calling the show. I need people like you to help me out and get through this, especially when I'm all by myself on the air.
Trust me, I'll call again.
All right, bud. Thank you. Keep your head on the swivel. Hey, guys. We just found out that Olivia Newton-John just died. I'm going to cry during the commercial break, I think.
Ouch.
Yeah, dude. You were pointing over my shoulder, and I didn't know. I was like, what's going on? And then I look back. I see that Fox News headline, and I'm like, oh.
I figured that. I mean, you hadn't known. Somebody had messaged me a little bit ago and told me, and then I saw it up on the screen. I didn't think that you probably had heard yet.
No, I had not.
It's
just
sad because
she was my first like love as a child. Yeah, you know,
I was about to say that.
I think crush. You know, that whole the video for Let's Get Physical, I think that
solidified it.
That might have been it.
That was like 1982.
There might have been some serious me time involving that video when I was a child.
I think a lot of guys our age can identify, maybe a little bit older as well.
Yeah.
Can identify.
Oh, I know my dad thought she was hot, you know. My dad's probably in his 80s, so he's probably 10 years older than her, you know. Yeah, he's 82.
I can't believe she was 73.
Yeah.
She battled for a long time.
Would she die?
I guess it was the cancer. That she had had, that she'd been battling for years, finally got her, is what I'm assuming from what I've read, what little I've read.
Yeah, it gets a lot of Americans, I'll tell you that. It gets a lot of people, but gets a lot of Americans, and that's why I love bringing Crystal on the show, you know, because she and Jamie Spicer and Jen Spicer from Precision Fitness, they can teach you. You know, like I can teach you how to protect your home. I can teach you how to protect yourself. I can teach your daughter how to protect herself. I can teach your mom how to protect herself. But I need people to teach me how to live longer, right? I can live longer by avoiding, de-escalating, and winning in a violent situation. But I have a much, much higher chance of dying from some sort of cancer related to some sort of product that I'm using, food that I'm eating, crap that I'm putting in my body on a regular basis or on my body. And so that's why I look to professionals like Crystal or Jamie and Jen, you know, to help me change my diet, to try to minimize the exposure I have to carcinogens. You know, the one I haven't been able to figure out yet that Crystal's always talking about is the deodorant, though. I haven't found a deodorant that doesn't have aluminum in it that actually works. And so that's currently my challenge. If you know of a deodorant that'll work on a man that works out every day that doesn't have aluminum in it, I would love to try that. Because so far I've been able to clean up my diet. I try not to eat fast food as much as possible, like maybe once a month, once every 2 weeks, something like that, and then not a ton of it. I try not to drink soda ever. You know, and this is coming from a guy that when I was a kid, I drank soda every day. When I was a police officer, hell, I drank 5 32-ounce Diet Cokes every day, smoked a pack of cigarettes, you know, ate fast food every day. And that is unfortunately what most of you guys are still doing out there, because it's either A, it's fast. Well, it's not as fast as it used to be. B, it's cheap, but it's not as cheap as it used to be. It's actually faster and cheaper now to eat real food you cook yourself because of all this BS inflation and everything. But I don't know. I got on this tangent because Olivia Newton-John died of cancer, that I want you guys to not die of cancer. So I want you to do everything in your power. I want you to drink a gallon of water a day. I want you to stop drinking soda. I want you to, you know, stop eating food fried with seed oils. Start using olive oils and start using other things that are better for you. Make changes to your life and to your diet to become a better weapon. Your mind is the weapon. Your body is the weapon. Long before that, the weapon is the weapon. Does that make sense? You need to be able to think clearly. You need to be able to survive an altercation. You need to be able to have stamina. You know, Fish, I started running. Can you believe that?
My nose started running. Really? When did you start running?
Oh, like a week or two ago, honestly. You know, and I hate running. Trust me. I mean, I'm the guy like...
ran back in the day when you were a police officer.
I ran back in the day when I was in the police academy, right?
Right.
So when I went in the academy at 20 years old, I ran... To get in the academy, I had to run a 10-minute mile, okay? And I pulled that off. I had to do some training.
I ran then.
Yeah. So I got in the... And when I got out of the academy, I was running a 7-minute mile. But when I got out of the academy, I swore to God I would never run again. Because I know running's not nearly as healthy as walking is for you. And that's why I started out walking like 2.5 miles every day. But then the walking got a little old and I started pushing myself. Because again, Pat McNamara, former Green Beret, he said something one time that has stuck with me. He said that if you can clone yourself today, the you in 2 or 3 days should be able to whip the clone's butt. You need to be able to whoop your own butt from only a couple days ago. You need to always be getting better, faster, stronger. And so that's why I started running. The first mile I think I did in like 14 minutes. Then I got it down to 12. Now I'm at 11:18. So I'm almost back to where I was when I was 20 before I went to the academy. Wow. We'll see where this goes. I have to run with my phone though in case somebody has to call 911 for me.
I'll run with you. I can make it a block maybe.
All right, yeah, we'll see you tomorrow here on Shots Fired, hopefully with better news. Rest in peace, Olivia.